because, you know, what Helga discussed was, on the one hand, the classical tradition, the tradition of the Weimar classics in Germany, which is something that, from the very beginning, I've been a member of this organization since 1972, and from the very beginning, one of the things that attracted me was Lynn's emphasis on the importance of classical culture, of Beethoven and Mozart, Heine, Schiller, and actually having, over the years, the opportunity to explore the richness of the development of these great geniuses who have given us the capacity to think and improve our own capacity to be creative. But at the same time, the other thing that drew me to the organization was what Lynn calls the conjunctural perspective. That is, when I joined in 72, we'd already gone past the August 1971 breakup of the Bretton Woods system by Nixon. And we were heading down this road where today, almost 30 years later, we're at the point of a full breakdown of the financial system. And with that, we've also gone 30 more years toward a dark age. Now, the essence of a dark age is the attack on the idea of the classical mind, the classical method of thinking. And so what I'm going to do is contrast, following up what Helga did, again, the classical versus one of the most insidious operations against the classical tradition, which is that of Romanticism. Now, to set the stage for this, we actually start on January 30th, 1933. I hope people can see this. I don't know if, well, Nick doesn't have to see it. He's already seen these. January 30th, 1933, the takeover of power in Germany by Adolf Hitler and the Nazis. Now, this occurred at the end of a month of activity, which included a political conspiracy by a number of people who were committed to bringing Hitler to power for a variety of reasons. But these people involved in this included the president of Germany at the time, Hindenburg, who was by that time pretty much on the verge of senility. But he was being manipulated during this period by, among others, Chancellor von Papen. That's von Papen. And that's Otto Meissner, who was the aide to Hindenburg. Meissner was the typical technocrat. He served Hindenburg, and then he served von Papen, and then after von Papen left, he became the assistant to Hitler. So he was one of these non-ideological types. But what was involved, and there's an article by Michael Liebig in a recent New Federalist, that if people want to get a picture of this conspiracy, you can, because I just want to briefly show you this political side of it. The person who's key to know in this was von Schleicher. Now, von Schleicher had been the chancellor immediately before Hitler, Kurt von Schleicher, who had been a general. Now, what's important to know about von Schleicher is that he had an economic plan which included FDR-style job training programs. Because this political conspiracy to overthrow von Schleicher and bring in Hitler occurred in the depths of the Depression. There were millions of unemployed in Germany. There'd been hopelessness that went back to the end of World War I. Because after World War I, the rest of the world met at Versailles and blamed Germany for World War I and imposed reparations on Germany. To pay the reparations, Germany, which had already, World War I was a horrible, horrible war where tens of thousands of people died fighting over an area the distance between here and the National Center. They'd move 5 feet per month, trench warfare, gases, brutal bayonets and charges and countercharges, and it was not military strategy of the flank, as Lynn talks about. It was a brutal meat grinder war. And then after the war, Germany was hit with reparations. To pay the reparations, the economy was further destroyed, which led to the Weimar hyperinflation in 1923, which then led to austerity. It led to depression after 1929, And so here we were in 1932-33, in the midst of a depression, in the midst of a horrible depression. And it was in this period that Hitler was brought in to power. And the illusion was that Hitler could be contained. The illusion of people who overthrew von Schleicher was they could contain him, but they didn't want von Schleicher's economic reforms, which were the reforms based on Friedrich List, Henry Carey, job programs, and so on. So just keep in mind as the backdrop for what I'm going to talk about, that in the United States, when the Depression hit, we had Franklin Roosevelt. In Germany, when the Depression hit, it was the overthrow of Schleicher and then Hitler. Now, politically, there was this conspiracy that Michael Liebig writes about. But that wasn't the whole story. Nor was the economic crisis the whole story. What we're going to take a look at is, in a sense, two paradoxes. I want to pose these to you, and I want you to keep them in your mind as you get this picture of the cultural warfare that was launched in Germany. How is it that in a nation which had the Weimar classics, with Schiller, Heine, Beethoven, how could such a country also produce a Hitler? How could a population which grows up, and if you talk to any of our German members today, they'll tell you they grow up with this music, the beautiful music. They grow up with the poetry. Most of our German members, the older members anyway, can still recite Schiller because they studied in school. How could you have a culture that, or a society that has that culture, that could tolerate the barbarity of the Nazi period? And then secondly, how can you have a theory of radical individualism produce human cattle? Think about this. The culture that we're going to look at promoted the idea of the heroic individual over nature. The heroic individual of the gods of Olympus. How can such a view make a population passive, pessimistic, and susceptible to the idea of the great marches and parades and pageantry of Nazi Germany? Now, to get at this question, I want to begin with Friedrich Schiller and the classical tradition, just to review it again. I think from Helga you got a fairly good sense of this, but there are a couple of points that are just important to grasp. The key thing, the key question that determines your outlook and what you're going to do with your life is your view of man. And whether you know it or not, you have a view of man. And the problem is most people don't know they have a view of man. That's what an axiom is. An axiom is when you have a belief that you don't know where the belief came from. It's something that's, if you look it up in a dictionary, it's something which is accepted without proof. And as you know, Lynn doesn't think you know anything unless you can prove it. There's no such thing as a discovery without being able to prove it. Otherwise, you're just memorizing. So if you think about today, for example, we do a lot of work both in Texas and California on the campuses. And I can tell you, there are very many people who, when they first meet us, say things like, well, I agree with everything except I think animals have feelings and animals have cognition, and you can't say man is over the animal. We've got to embrace the animal kingdom, and on and on and on. I gave a talk the other day in Seattle, and at a certain point someone said to me, I had mentioned paganism as something bad, and someone said, what's wrong with paganism? And I had to think for a minute and say, oh yeah, I'm on a campus, okay. All right, let me tell you. Now, this is what axioms are. You have certain beliefs that you don't even know. They're part of the culture. And what's part of this culture today? You think about, those of you who have been on a campus recently, it's the idea that life is unfolding before me with no plan. There's no direction to it. I've got to do my own thing. Of course, this was the slogan of Pat and my generation. You know, do your own thing. You know, is doing your own thing, everyone going out and buying a t-shirt that says Tommy Hilfiger on it? Did people just suddenly decide one day to buy those kind of t-shirts? No, your own thing is imposed on you, but you start thinking it's your own thing. Yeah, I wore bell bottoms when I was in college. That was my thing. And so same thing with other 35,000 other people at the University of Wisconsin. Suddenly we decided to be ourselves by growing long hair. You know, so this question of what you believe and what you think of yourself is part of a cultural paradigm where there are conceptions that you never reached on your own, that were there. And what's interesting to see, there are some people here from the World War II and post-World War II generation who had a whole different set of conceptions and axioms about what it means to be man. Think about what it means coming back from a depression and a war, where you have to renew your sense that man is created in the image of God and we have to improve the world, where you're willing to go out and die for a country. I mean, who would willingly go out and die for George W. Bush? So today, the idea of military service is, you know, it's a job. Whereas military service should be your commitment to preserving the ideals of a nation. Well, what happens when you lose those ideals? So I just think it's important to realize and to become self-conscious of what it is that shapes your sense of identity, because that's the central issue for Lynn in looking at these questions of what is a culture. What is your idea of the purpose of man? Now, the classical tradition, which begins in its modern form with the Greeks 2,500 years ago, developed by Homer, Solon of Athens, and then later finding its greatest expression in the tragedies of Aeschylus and Sophocles and in Schiller, that idea is one which starts with the central feature being a connection between beauty, virtue, and happiness. And is an optimistic outlook, the idea that man is in this world to create something, to do something good, to leave the world better. And what you find later in Judaism and Christianity, the Judeo-Christian tradition, is the idea that the world is moving towards something. There is progress, there is advance, that we're not just here to exist for a period of time, to take up space, to eat, to procreate, to do other sorts of things. If you scratch, if you itch, scratch it. But that in fact, there's a direction in history. There's progress. The idea of progress is central to this classical idea. And what does progress come from? It comes from advancing knowledge, making new discoveries. The unexamined life is not worth living, is a statement that Socrates once made, that you're always questioning. You question everything about what you think, what you believe, where it came from, and that's how you fight for truth. You may not know the absolute truth in your lifetime, because it may not be possible to ever know absolute truth, because we have a short life. We exist, you know, when you're young, you think you're going to live forever. But forever tends to be about 70, maybe 80, 90 years. Maybe in your generation, 100 years. But in the scale of history, that's not very long. And so we may never get to absolute truth, but it's that fight for truth, the attempt to discover these higher principles, which is what makes you virtuous and also makes you happy. And that's where real happiness exists. Now, Lynn, a number of years ago, talked about what he sees as the four principles of the classical outlook. And I just want to read these to you. This is what he said should govern man's daily practice. The first is love of truth, as reason enables us to discover truth ever less imperfectly. So love of truth is the first. Secondly, the love of the divine spark of reason in other persons, those who have died and those yet to be born, as much as the living. The love of the divine spark of reason in others is the second point. The third, love of beauty, as reason enables us to prove that which is beautiful. And as you know from Schiller, there is an objective principle of beauty. It's not in the eye of the beholder. But there are laws which govern what is beautiful. And fourth, love of work, as truth, love of humanity, and love of beauty instruct us what our work should be. Now, that is what it means to be free, And that's what agape is, that principle, that guiding spirit of love toward this creation, and the commitment of each individual to improve that creation, to live your life so that the world will be better for your having lived it, and that you give meaning to those who went before you and those come after you. The term Lynn uses for that is the simultaneity of eternity. So even with our short life, we can affect that which went before us by making sure those sacrifices that led to advances are preserved and then given a future. That's just what I mean by directionality of history as progress. Now, the beautiful soul for Schiller, picking up on Plato's conception, is one in whom reason and feeling, duty and passion coalesce. That there's no difference between your duty and what you want to do. He who does his duty with joy, he who takes his responsibilities and does them out of love of humanity, instinctively choosing the good. That's what Schiller means by the education of one's emotions. And this is what Lynn means by reason, that you decide, you make a cognitive choice as to what you're going to do with your life, which brings you joy and does good for others as a conscious, deliberate effort, as opposed to just going along to get along, as opposed to just doing your own thing in your own time, in your own place. So that's a very different conception. And I would recommend, if you want a beautiful story of this, that you read Schiller's play, Joan of Arc, The Virgin of Orleans, in which you see how a young, uneducated peasant girl came to take this conception of duty and then go beyond duty to total love. And the ultimate sacrifice of Joan, which, as Lynn said, is what enabled France to become the first modern nation state, the first nation state. That will give you a sense of the internal struggle. Because Joan just didn't come along and go out and fight and kill everybody and do good things and then die. Actually, she was killed by the British working through corrupt elements of the church. It's always a struggle. Now, I'll just add this as a sort of footnote. If it were the struggle, then life would be kind of boring. I mean, if we were all just born as completed souls who just could, you know, romp through the tulips, what would this life be? The fact is that each of us has to work to perfect ourselves, to improve ourselves, to develop our emotions so that we can be good. Now, that's not a bad task. It's not an onerous task, because the beautiful and the good and truth are all the same. Now, if you have this outlook, and this is what Schiller was fighting for, and if a society is organized around these principles, life is good. The world is interesting. But it also is a world in which, if you say that everybody has the right to participate in that, then you can't have an oligarchy. Because the principle of the oligarchy, as Lynn elaborated over and over and over, is to keep most of the population as human cattle, so that all they're interested in is itching and scratching and sex and drugs and music and rhythm and sleeping and these kinds of things, where occasionally an idea comes through your head. And what's the idea? Where are we going to go party tonight? That's considered the tough choices you have to make. If you've ever found yourself in that circumstance, you know what it means to be a human cattle. And I believe that probably some of you have experienced that in your lifetime. Now, and you thought it was your own choice. I'm free. And in that sense, by the way, a lot of you probably think that fascism is getting grounded. Now, the reason we have to look at Wagner and Nietzsche, and I'm going to concentrate mostly on Wagner, although I'll mention a few things about Nietzsche, is that what we're dealing with here was a conscious, organized deployment by the oligarchy, where you can see clearly, step by step by step, how they created beasts, how they created Nazis, how they turned human beings who should have love toward their fellow man, into murderous creatures who targeted populations and with ruthless, cold-blooded killing, and how they had a view of man in which some people are not fit for survival. Only the strong survive, only the beautiful. And beauty, in this case, is a physical ideal, not a cognitive ideal. So how did they do this? How did they create this? Well, Helga went through some of this in talking about Friedrich von Schlegel in her presentation on Sunday. Because Schlegel was the one of the key guys in bringing what was called the Romantic movement. And I think as you made a discovery, the word romantic, the key to it is right here, Roman. Now, as Helga said, what do most people think of the Romantic movement? Well, a candlelight dinner on a lake, someone who you're attracted to, you know, a bottle of wine, beer, marijuana, opium, hashish, acid, whatever is your thing. Love, I love you, and this kind of thing. That's it. And usually in the background, some kind of music for the appropriate, you know, for the older generation, it might be Sinatra. For the current generation, it might be Clash or Nine Inch Nails. But that's the simple level. And people who fall for that are already in the state of being human cattle. And it's not always your fault. You've got to make people aware. You've got to organize people to see that this is what they've chosen. But actually, there's a... And in this notion of romantic, it's the idea that it's the emotions of the heart. That's what's driving you. I'm sensitive. I'm getting in touch with my feminine side. Or if you're a man. If you're a woman, you don't want to be in touch with your feminine side. Or I'm letting the inner child come out. And as Lynn said about Bush the other day, he once made it to childhood, but he has since regressed. He's in touch with his inner infant. But that's the simple level of romanticism. There's a much more sophisticated side, which is that we are what we see, touch, taste, and hear. We're creatures of our senses. You can't know anything except something that is visible. Now, if you know anything about sight, and I'm sure Bruce Director might take this up a little bit, your sight is very deceptive. What you see is deceptive. If you don't know what you're hearing, what you hear is deceptive. These are aspects of our physical being which have to be developed by an active creative mind, because if it's just what you see and hear, you can be fooled. You don't see reality. Reality is something you have to discover. But the Romantics operate from this idea that it's not just the emotions of the heart that are more valid than the thoughts of the head, but that there's something called the soul, or something that's not connected to reason, that exists outside of you. And what you see when you look at someone like Wagner is an absolutely conscious effort to bestialize and brutalize people by making them captive, or making them their senses the controlling influence, taking them away from thought, away from reason. Now, there are several axioms that are associated with the... Oh, by the way, the other thing, if you're more sophisticated, that is, if you've taken Music 101 in college, music appreciation or something like that, what they'll say is that one night after dinner, Ludwig von Beethoven became a romantic. And all of music shifted that night from the classical style to the romantic style. And then, of course, at some point around 1900, they decided the romantic style was silly and they became modern, which means that tone deaf and so on, noisy, irrational, and so on. Well, this is a complete fraud, because you had classical method of composition, which has nothing to do with time periods, because the beginnings of the classics were the Greek tragedies. So the classical and the classical tradition should be extended today, and some of you, or perhaps some of the people you organize, will be the composers who can restore the classical tradition to poetical writing, to poetry, to music, and so on. But this idea that there are periods of time in which the zeitgeist moves people, the spirit of the times moves you in a different direction, is something that was created so PhD candidates can write books to pollute the minds of their susceptible students. But there are axioms that are embedded within this romantic view, one of which is that man should be at one with nature. It's the idea that, you know, this idea that Genesis, that God gave man dominion over nature, forget that. That's what creates modern aggressive man. And instead, you've got to love nature, love the daffodils, hug trees, and so on. And that if you take man out of the natural environment, you make him unnatural. Now, what do they really mean when they say that? This is where you see the influence of Freud and others, which is beyond the scope of the presentation today. Will may take some of this up later. But this idea is that we're really a beast inside. We're totally sensuous, a sensual being. And that because of civilization, we put up a civilized mask. And we all hide behind the mask, but really, what are we interested in? We're just like dogs, aren't we? We see a fire hydrant, we know what to do with it. You have to free that real self. And what causes neurosis is the mask, is what you put up in front of you. And that's what they teach you. And they don't even teach you that. You just learn that. So, what are some of the other axioms? You've got to have man back in his natural environment. Urban society is evil because it's artificial. Industry is evil because you're polluting, you're looting nature, you're ripping up the soil. Writing, I mean, paper is probably bad because you're killing trees. And also that there was once a simple golden age where man lived in harmony with nature. And that we've got to get back to that. We've got to get rid of these artifices. Now, underlying this further is what I would call aspects of the oligarchical worldview. And you have to realize, oligarchs actually are educated to think this way. They believe things such as the world evolves in cycles. That it's not man moving toward progress in some direction, but it's phases of construction and destruction. Death and destruction, in fact, are desirable because the weak get killed off and the strong survive. This is the Darwinian idea, the struggle for the survival of the fittest, that each of you is locked in mortal combat with each other to see who can get more resources, or in the language of today, more toys before you die than the other. That in this view, science and technology and technological progress are threats because they tend to break the cycle of rise and fall. Oh.
Don't do that.
Gee. I'm telling you, these technical guys will run everything. Now I've got to stand like this so I don't hit the mics. So if I look like I'm regressing to ape-like status, it's in John's direction. Yeah. Now, a second point of this oligarchical worldview is that man's nature is fixed. We may think we're getting better, but we're really just a naked ape. In fact, there was a book that came out when we were in college called The Naked Ape, which attacks such things as deodorant and things of that sort. Man's nature is fixed and inclined towards evil, because the sensual side of you is more powerful than the creative side. Now also in this view, this oligarchical view, there is no natural law. Think of Scalia on this. So there should be no laws governing society except the laws that the powerful can impose to sustain their own rule. So force, brute power, that's what determines law and justice. And then fourth, in order to sustain this society, you need mechanisms of mass control to enforce the backwardness. You cultivate myths. You get people to associate with myths, like the Mother Earth, Gaia, for example, blood and soil cults, the idea that you have to be close to nature. Now, just to review this one more time so you have a good sense of this when we start looking at Wagner. The romantic view was explicitly an attack on the classical view of man. It was in opposition to urbanization and industrialization. It sought a cultural cohesion to unite people, the idea of the folk. We are one people. Looking for precedents from a previous golden age, and to create a spiritual revival that would have some kind of organic correspondence between the individual and society, which is summed up in the notion of the folk. The Volk is the German word, the people. The people as an organic unity connected to nature. Now, this is where you begin to see where Wagner came from. Now let me try and figure out how I'm going to use these transparencies here.
Yeah, Harley, that's what I don't want you to do. That.
Shuffling. Well, I try not to be a paper shuffler, but...
There you go. No, not the shuffling, but the banging on the microphone.
All right, John. This is... It's not the young John Wayne. That is... But it does look a little like John Wayne. That is Richard Wagner. Now, Wagner was born in 1813, and as a young man was an enthusiast of Mozart and Beethoven. As, how could you not be? I mean, if you grow up with the music of Mozart, it's something that brings you joy all of your life. Not just simple joy, but Mozart as a creative genius. The function of a creative genius is to discover insights into the creative process, and then whether it's through language, music, the arts, to show that process, that method of genius, so it makes it accessible to other people. Now, what happened with Wagner, though, is at the same time he loved this music, you had this whole romantic culture. And one of the key characters in this was a man named Hoffman, who Helga mentioned, E.T.A. Hoffman, who wrote these tales of fantasies and ghosts and spirits and so on. And Wagner wrote in his autobiography, and if people wish to pursue this, it's not a bad thing to look at, although don't immerse yourself in it. But he wrote that Hoffman developed in me a mania and caused me to adopt the most eccentric way of looking at the world, to get outside of reality and live in a world of fantasy. Now, at a certain point, around the 1840s, Wagner concluded that he had to run away from the classical tradition, that the classical tradition was an impediment to his real freedom. And so he wrote of the influence of Felix Mendelssohn, who was a composer, a contemporary composer. And Mendelssohn was very influential in Leipzig, Dresden, the towns where Wagner lived. He wrote of Mendelssohn that the experience of Mendelssohn's influence in Leipzig fortified me in my disgust at everything affecting a classical aroma. So he explicitly concluded that he had to reject the classical method. Now, in 1848, 1849, there were revolts in Germany. There were the attempts to establish republics. It was a fairly weak effort, but it was an attempt to break out of the Congress of Vienna, Metternich, imposition of, an early British world order. And one of the things they did, as they always do, the oligarchy will create left and right wing counter gangs. You know, you have on the one side the moral majority, on the other side you have the libertines, if it feels good, do it. And you have this kind of phony battle. Well, one of the key characters in promoting this in those days was a Russian named Bakunin. He was one of the founders of the so-called anarchist movement. And Bakunin, according to Wagner, wanted to cause the annihilation of all civilization. In other words, civilization, urban culture, this is all bad. And Wagner said, and he spent a lot of time with Bakunin, he said that he found in him the purest humanitarian idealism. Think about that, humanitarian idealism and wishing the annihilation of civilization. He said it was the purest humanitarian idealism combined with a savagery utterly inimical to all culture. And thus my relations with him fluctuated between instinctive horror and irresistible attraction. Now in 1849, Wagner joined the demonstrators trying to overthrow the government in Dresden. And he wrote after this experience from exile in Switzerland, because they came to arrest him. He wrote, "My task is this, to bring revolution wherever I go." He later said, "My task is this, to bring destruction wherever I go." And his view of Mozart changed. At the end, he said, Mozart's operas are at bottom frivolous for the upper classes. Now, of course, this is somewhat interesting, since Wagner's whole career was funded by the elite of southern Germany, the oligarchy. Now, before I introduce you to a little bit more of his music, let me just tell you something about his theory of music versus the classical tradition. And I think John and Renee are doing a class, and I'm sure they'll talk more about this. Okay. Well, music is not about the senses, real classical music, but about ideas. And classical composition is the working out of a musical idea, a new idea, which expresses the essence of man, the creative power, and advances the creative process. Now, Lyndon LaRouche, in writing about this in an article last year called Prometheus and Europe, which is in the spring 2000 issue of Fidelio, writes that a musical idea, such as any idea, is never conveyed in words. That is, when you speak of it, when you try to put it into words, it's diminished. As Lynn said, ideas do not reside within any literal language itself. All decent poetry is premised upon the principle of ideas, meaning Platonic ideas. All ideas, whether in science or classical art, are metaphors, whose existence lies entirely outside any literal reading of language itself, as opposed to Scalia, for whom the word is primary. Now, Schiller talks about this in how he wrote poetry, and talking of his classical, the way he developed his classical method. He said a poem starts with a musical idea. He said, "In the beginning, my perception is without a defined and clear object. This forms itself only later. A certain basic emotion of music proceeds, and not only this, and only after this, rather, does the poetic idea follow." Now, if you saw William Warfield sing "Take My Mother Home" the other day, just as an example, and I think most of you were at the concert. Now, what's the topic of this song, just to give you an idea, "Take My Mother Home"? It's Jesus going to his death. And what's his concern? He's being spit on. He's having his clothes raffled off. He's getting nailed into the cross. He's dying. And what's his concern? "Please don't let my mother have to suffer by seeing this." And with this is just a simple example. But when Warfield sings this, the whole idea of Jesus takes on a totally different conception for you. The pain and the suffering, the passion of Christ, summed up both as man, as God, but also as man. The pain, not for his own death, but for the suffering of his mother. And I don't know about the rest of you, but whenever I hear him sing this, and I've heard him sing this now a number of times, it brings tears to my eyes. Because it's such a haunting, powerful expression of an idea. Even though the idea is never expressed in there. It's just the narrative of the stages of the crucifixion. But the idea of Jesus as a living being, as man and God, is something that you can't express in the words. That's what Lynn is talking about. Now, for Wagner, it's all about words and the senses, to create a visual and audio overwhelming experience that removes any thinking. Wagner was writing about what he wanted to do with music. And he said, "I never wished for fame." So you know right off the bat he's lying. But he went on to say, "I just wanted something that was distinctly mine. A real melody that was my own. I never went in for the sophisticated ponderings like Schumann," Robert Schumann, who was one of the great classical composers. Now, in his operas, what Wagner did is to replace opera with musical drama. Now, not even musical drama, just drama. Now, Mozart also had this idea that it's the music that carries it. And if you've been at a Mozart opera, obviously the words mean something, there's a storyline, there are characters who develop, but you're moved by the music. And the music becomes the idea, and then the ideas that are expressed in the music take life in front of you. And you have the same response you have at any good classical drama, which is that you're drawn to characters, you look at the characters, you identify with some, and then you see their flaws. For example, in Don Giovanni, I don't know if you are familiar with this, but the character Leporello is very much like a Sancho Panza. Or in The Magic Flute, Papageno, the Birdman. Just an average guy, nice guy, not a bad person, but consumed by the senses, the here and now. And in Leporello, he's a servant to a rapist killer, Don Giovanni. And so you see in this character the tug on the one hand to be like Don Giovanni. As he's reading the list of thousands of women that Don Giovanni seduced, he says, why can't I just get one? At the same time, Don Giovanni is kicking him and beating him and treating him miserably, and the audience sort of like Leporello. I wouldn't mind getting in on this, but, you know, I really couldn't do what he's doing. So you get the audience to identify and to look at the characters and identify their own flaws in themselves. Or as in Hamlet, the way Lynn talks about Hamlet. That's the principle of tragedy and drama. But what Wagner does is he presents these legends where it's not so much that you identify with anyone as you're overwhelmed by the whole experience. And instead of ensemble singing, duets, trios, where you have counterpoint and inversions and interplay between the musical voices, it's long declamation that goes on and on and on and on. You know, in the Cadre school we had in California just recently, I hadn't clipped the tape the way I wanted, so I had one of these songs that I'll play just a little bit for you. I put it on, and we played about 2 or 3 minutes, then I pushed fast forward for about 5 minutes, put it back on play, and it was still going on. The same thing over and over and over. It's the eternal recurrence in the music. Now, but the words are words of magic, mysticism, images. And you have a heightening of the passions, the senses take over. And it's this idea of a total visual experience, drowning with what Lynn calls the fundamental emotion. Now, do we have the tape recorder? Yeah. Is it plugged in, do you know? All right, now that I've told you how bad this is, I want you to listen, if I can find this, and you know how to open it? Okay. All right, I want you to listen to something. This is Wagner. You see why we have to have a technical staff. Anyone ever heard this? No, it's a bridal march from Lohengrin. Now, does this sound bad? Well, let me be honest. What do you think? You like this? Actually, I'll tell you, I think it's somewhat charming. The evil is not necessarily in the music, but if you listen, it just keeps going. There's no development. Good hold and swelling. Well, that goes on for another hour or so. You know, the honeymoon's over by the time the bridal march ends. Now, I'm not going to go through that. I mean, Wagner's operas are, they're literally the insane ideas of the inner pit, what Lynn calls the pit, where you have the creatures that, when you wake up as a kid with a nightmare, and you have some snake, beast, dragon that partly looks like your uncle or something like that in your mind. You know you've been, you couldn't sleep all night, you've been running away from monsters. That's what these operas are. The pit comes out. I'll just give you an example of a couple of them. One is Tristan und Isolde, which is about a princess who's betrothed to a prince in another country. She doesn't want to go. And Tristan, that's Isolde, Tristan is sent to take her there. And so she asks a witch to brew her a potion that will kill her. But instead, the witch brews a love potion. And so she falls in love with the captain of the ship who's to take her back to the person she's supposed to marry. And you have a story. Love is not based on who they are. It's externally imposed by the love potion. But the opera as a whole, the whole second act, is a love-death scene. I think I have just a section of it. And this one literally does go on for 45 minutes. And it literally does go on practically forever. Now, this is, Lynn talked in the Beyond Psychoanalysis paper years ago of this idea of the fundamental emotion, that you think that being overwhelmed, and think about it, when you have your first crush on somebody, and it's, you know, if you're a little guy and there's this cute girl sitting next to you and it's all you can think about, and you write little poems to her that you never give her, you make hearts, you carve her initials in a tree or something next to your name, and it's an obsessive consuming, and then, you know, you're afraid to talk to her and finally you do, and boom. But this, the idea of the fundamental emotion is when you're completely swept away, which for Wagner is the ultimate desire, because you have the senses overwhelm the idea. Now, this idea of creative destruction takes its modern form in economics. That's what Paul Volcker's controlled disintegration is. There was a Viennese economist, Schumpeter, in the early 1900s, who wrote about the creative destruction of ending one paradigm with a new one. Think about the new technology, the high technology, new economy. It's the same thing, these ideas. Now, of course, in this, in Tristan and Isolde, they both die together, and that's the uplifting ending. Now, he took this whole series called The Ring Cycle, Der Ring des Nibelungen, which is the Nordic myths. And again, I'm just going to go through this briefly. You can look into this yourself if you want. But they're basically the story of these prehistoric gods whose wealth is stolen by these little dwarf elf-type people who, and when they're portrayed on the stage, look a lot like Jews. Because Wagner, as you'll see in a moment, became a violent anti-Semite. But the idea is these Jews, these civilizers, are taking the gold and destroying nature. And the gods, meanwhile, are struggling to preserve nature and to preserve their power. And it's a four-part cycle which ends with Die Götterdämmerung, the twilight of the gods, in which they conclude that everything will be destroyed. It ends with a huge fire burning down Valhalla, where the heroes are taken when they die. And the good news is, it's going to happen all over again. There's going to be another rebirth. And that, again, no progress, but these operas, each one of them, each of the four, last 4 to 5 hours. And I want to give you a sense of the characters you meet in them. And keep in mind, this is before there was Madonna. Now, I didn't make this up. That's one of the Valkyries. And the Valkyries are the women who take the dead heroes and lift them up and take them into Valhalla. Now, think about, well, that's the point. Think about, exactly. Think about Warfield's recitation of Come Down Death, the idea of the angel of death coming down and soothing Sister Caroline's passing and taking her into the loving arms of Jesus where she's rocked and rest. You can now rest. Your toil is done. Imagine the heroic figure in a Wagner opera. You wouldn't want to die. You know, I'm not going to be pulled to her breast. But now listen to the music. The music of this. And some of you will recognize this, I'm sure. See, I told you, this keeps going. You should ask Mike Billington, by the way, to give you his example of the Liebestod, because he did a little parody of it, which is quite funny. The Ride of the Valkyries. Is there any purpose to this part of the music? The heroic gods. But you got to hear the Valkyries sing. I'm going to let it go for a minute. Keep your eyes on the Valkyrie. Whoops. Wait. All right. Remember, you're dying and you're about to be transported to Valhalla. Enough of that. Now, that's not exactly something you're looking forward to, dying and encountering the Valkyries. It's a nightmare. But it's a nightmare leading to what? The destruction of everything. So don't worry about it. This is existentialism. There's no purpose in life except the heroic death. And that's only for the strong. If you're one of the human cattle, you die and no one cares. The Valkyries don't come for you. You have nothing. Now, I just want to read a couple quotes for you from contemporaries of Wagner. One was Clara Schumann, who was the wife of Robert Schumann, a very good composer in her own right and very important person. And she wrote, "I decided to go see the Rheingold, which is one of the four of the Ring Cycle." She said, "I felt as if I were wading in a swamp the whole evening. The one good thing about the opera is that one is not deafened by the brass as one is in his other operas. The boredom that one must endure, however, is dreadful. In every scene, the actors on stage are in a cataleptic trance in which they remain fixed for such a long time that one cannot look at them anymore. The women have just a few measures to sing in the entire opera and just stand around forever. In general, they are nothing at all but tattered, villainous gods." Now, in a staging, they created a place called Bayreuth, which was a special theater where they still perform Wagner to this day, with cliffs, and it's a magnificent, supposedly huge stage. We're going to have horses riding across and witches flying across and things of that sort. But mostly in Wagner staging, they have light so that you have so that people actually appear to be tiny, and then these giants. And then, of course, the Brunhilde, which is where the Brunhilde came from, is one of the Valkyries, the queen of the Valkyries. So it's, again, sensual. Now, Clara Schumann later said, in the evening we went to see Tristan und Isolde. That was the most disgusting thing I've ever seen or heard in my life. To be forced to see and hear such crazy lovemaking the whole evening, in which every feeling of decency is violated, and by which not just the public, but even the musicians seem to be enchanted. This is the saddest thing I've experienced in my entire artistic life. I remained to the end since I wanted to hear the whole thing. During the entire second act, the two of them sleep and sing. Through the entire last act, for fully 40 minutes, Tristan dies. They call that dramatic, she said. Now, her husband wrote a letter to Mendelssohn after he saw it. And what he said, after he saw Tannhäuser, which is another one, and he said, Wagner is certainly inventive beyond belief, but truly, he isn't capable of thinking out and writing four bars in succession of beautiful or hardly even competent music. Now, those people like Schumann, Mendelssohn, and others understood this problem, but Wagner became extremely popular. The pageant, and popular especially with the oligarchy. Now, I just want to present very briefly one other aspect of Wagner, then I want to summarize a couple of points. Wagner wrote an essay in 1850 called Judaism in Music. And in it, this is one of the most vile attacks, in which he starts out in the first paragraph saying, I shall explain people's instinctive dislike of Jewishness. And he talks about the emancipation of Jews in Germany, which happened as a part of the Weimar classical period. He said, our desire to give the Jews their rights. So again, think of our desire to give them their rights. No one gives you rights. You're born with rights. That's what we have in the Declaration of Independence. We are endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights. No, we gave them rights. And it sprang much more from principle than from real sympathy. And all the talking and writing about Jewish emancipation failed to mask our unwillingness to have any actual dealings with them. He goes on to say, we shall attempt to understand the involuntary repulsion aroused in us by the personality and customs of the Jews in order to justify this instinctive feeling, which is obviously stronger and more overpowering than our desire to be free of it. The Jew is the ruler and will continue, he wrote, will continue to rule. This is in a country where Jews were still largely, I mean, they had freedom, they had a certain amount of freedom, but still lived generally at the whim of the majority. But he said the Jews rule because of Jewish control over money. And he described money as those innocent pieces of paper which are stained with the blood of countless generations. Wagner writes, what the great artists have toiled to bring into being for 2,000 unhappy years, the Jew today turns into an art business. Emancipation from Judaism seems to us a prime necessity. And in the end of this essay, he calls for the Jewish question to be treated with the redemption of Ahasuerus, who was the ruler, the Persian ruler, who wanted to exterminate the Jews. And so you have in Wagner already the idea of emancipating Germany of Jews. Now, I just want to introduce you very briefly to Nietzsche. Some of you, did any of you ever study philosophy in college? You take classes where they, 19th century philosophy, and you read Hegel, Nietzsche, Kierkegaard. No one? Boy, are you lucky. It was imposed on me. Nietzsche actually has a certain, just like, you could tell Wagner's talented, but his idea in music is not to ever go anywhere. Nietzsche has these homilies, these little stories, but if you cut through it all, what do you find? You find someone who despises mankind. Has one understood me, he asks? Dionysius versus the crucified. Now, Dionysius was the god of wine and revelry in the Greek mythology, but especially the goat man. There are various portrayals, but it's basically the sensual man. And in attacking Schiller, even though he wrote a book called Birth of Tragedy, which became Wagner, he dedicated to Wagner. Nietzsche and Wagner were very close for a period of time. And what he believed is that great art comes from the orgiastic revelry, as opposed from creativity. The tragedy, the birth of tragedy, is with the Dionysian festivals in ancient Greece, which were the pagan romps, the mass orgies of that period. He was anti-Socratic. He said Socrates destroyed tragedy by trying to introduce reason. He writes of Jesus. He was also anti-Jesus. He said, Jesus died too early. He himself would have recanted his teaching had he reached my age. Nietzsche is known to some for his statement, God is dead. And I was told, somebody mentioned to me that there's a t-shirt there which says, God is dead, Nietzsche. And then under that it says, Nietzsche is dead, God. But here are a couple of other quotes from Nietzsche. Every notion of truth is necessarily false, since a true world does not exist. And another quote, existence such as it is, without purpose and without aim, but ineluctably returning without end into nothing. This is the only return. And so this idea that there's no progress, that there's no future, that it's all about the survival of the fittest, but meanwhile you have the pageants to keep the cattle happy. Now, Nietzsche, this is one of these interesting stories that someone should investigate. Nietzsche supposedly went insane in 1888, but it's one of these things like, how could you tell? You know, the famous scene in Hamlet where they figure Hamlet's crazy, what do we do with him? They say, let's send him to England so no one will know. You know, Nietzsche broke with Wagner over a specific issue, two specific issues. The first, and this was after he wrote Birth of Tragedy, and the two of them were arm in arm day after day, and all of a sudden they broke over two things. Wagner, who is anti-Christian, anti-Semitic, Wagner decided that since the population seems to be addicted to Christianity, that he would turn Christianity into mythology. And he wrote an opera called Parsifal. And this is about the Holy Grail, which reduces the idea of Christ, the divinity of Christ, to who can control the grail, the cup, in which his blood was contained. Now, of course, from reading, I'm sure some of you have read Lynn's article, Jesus Christ and Civilization, where he talks about the concept of God and Jesus as it being one that's intelligible. That is, that it's not just feeling, but it's actually this process of striving toward progress. What Wagner writes about in Parsifal is that the only person who can get the grail is a completely ignorant fool. And that's who Parsifal is. So that the true Christian, therefore, is based totally on feeling and then drinking the blood, turning the sacrament into this mythological function for the ignorant. And again, it's feeling. Now, that was his way of transforming Christianity into a cult. Nietzsche freaked out. Nietzsche said, how can you embrace Christianity? It's Jesus Christ that's the problem. It's Socrates that's the problem. You must have the Superman, the will to power, the radical individualism, which is also there in Wagner. And so this idea of the heroic, and Hitler said that he took from Wagner's operas the idea of the Führer principle, the ultimate leader who benignly rules over the sheep, but uses the sheep to purify by killing the Jews and eventually gypsies, homosexuals, Slavs, communists, socialists, Lutherans, Catholics, anyone he could kill, to destroy those who have some sense of reason. Now, Nietzsche 15 years after the supposed break with Wagner, writes the following: "All things considered, I could not have endured my youth without Wagner's music. For I was condemned to Germans. If one wants to rid oneself of an unbearable pressure, one needs hashish. Well then, I needed Wagner. Wagner is the antitoxin against everything German, a toxin, a poison. That I don't deny. From the moment there was a piano score of Tristan, I was a Wagnerian." Then he said Wagner became too German. So his two complaints was that he became too German and too Christian. But he says, "To this day, I'm still looking for a work of equally dangerous fascination, of an equally gruesome and sweet infinity as Tristan." Remember what Schumann said, that this is the worst thing she's ever seen, Clara Schumann. "Nietzsche, this is the greatest thing I've ever seen." He said, "The world is poor for anyone who has never been sick enough for this voluptuousness of hell. It is permitted, it is almost imperative to employ a formula of the mystics on this point. I think I know better than anyone else of what tremendous things Wagner is capable. The 50 worlds of alien ecstasies for which no one besides him had wings. And given the way I am, strong enough to turn even what is most questionable and dangerous to my advantage, and thus become stronger, I call Wagner the great benefactor of my life." Now, Nietzsche was Hitler's favorite philosopher, and Wagner his favorite composer. Now, it's ironic that to this day, Wagner is still performed, not only in Germany, but everywhere. And you'll find also, I just have these two final transparencies here, Wagner's daughter-in-law, and actually I should say his son-in-law, was Houston Stewart Chamberlain, who wrote the anti-Semitic tracts, which were used by Hitler in developing his ideas for the Nazi Party. Chamberlain, by the way, was the nephew of Joseph Chamberlain, who was the British Prime Minister at the turn of the century, who was the one who first launched the project of sending Jews from Europe to Palestine as a British wedge in the Middle East. That's another question, though. But Wagner's daughter-in-law, Winifred, used to refer to Hitler, to her grandchildren, that is, people who grew up in the 50s, after the war, as unser seliger Adolf, USA, Unser Selig, which means our blessed Adolf. And these were the two boys who ran the Bayreuth Festival and still run it to the present day. Now this is a picture of Hitler with Wieland and Wolfgang Wagner, who were the grandsons who ran the Bayreuth festivals, and this is Winifred Wagner, who to her dying day defended Hitler. And this is her two sisters with Hitler. Bayreuth is the city that Wagner built his big theater. And this is the two boys, Wieland and, what's the other one's name? Wieland and Wolfgang, with the person they called Uncle Wolf. Now, I would say that beautiful, that this was the music that was created to give the oligarchy a sense of power, a sense of return, that they were in touch with the old Norse legends of the prehistoric times, and that they were the gods of Olympus, and that they had the power over the world. But it's also part of this idea that you give the cattle, the human cattle, something, a pageant, to keep them excited and keep them in an emotional state. And that this was a very big part of inducing the pessimism that ultimately led to the Nazi takeover. That the population was so brutalized by the Depression, by World War I, and so hit with a counterculture, And some of you have seen the other side of this, if you've ever seen the show or the movie Cabaret, that you had almost the equivalent of the modern rave going on, this idea that anything is possible, do what you want. This leads to a brutalization. Now, I want to finish by showing you this a news clip from movie theaters from 1933. This particular one is from a couple of days after Hitler took power. Remember, his party lost 2 million votes in November 1932. That is, they had gotten up to about 36-38% of the vote, and then they started falling. So several months before von Hindenburg put Hitler in power as the chancellor, Hitler's party was collapsing. And so at the point where they could have been defeated and you could have had an FDR-style policy in Germany, instead you had the intrigues which led to his takeover in power. Now this will show you, just listen to the words, you can't see it too well because it's not a good picture, but listen to the words and you'll see the illusion that people had that Hitler could be contained.
Hitler, leader of a German national movement, is made Chancellor of Germany, and Berlin goes wild in celebration of his victory. Torchlights parade light the Berlin night as backers commemorate his victory by marching through the streets and through the Brandenburg Gate. Crowds of supporters raise their hands in the fascist salute, honoring both Hitler and German President von Hindenburg. A strident anti-communist, it took a month of secret negotiations and a new election for Hitler to win the chancellery, becoming only the third member of a Nazi party to join the German cabinet. He joins Dr. Wilhelm Frick and aviation minister Hermann Göring in running the German government. However, that minority is expected to change to a majority as the Hitler government takes shape. Hitler had to pull out all the stops to achieve victory in one of the most violent political campaigns ever and anywhere. And even as the Hitler victory was announced and the torchlight parades began, communist agitators began milling in the streets in protest. They posted handbills calling for a nationwide general strike. As they posted their bills, violence erupted on the streets of Berlin. As Nazis walked home after one of the torchlight parades, fights broke out. A police officer marching with the Nazis was shot to death by Reds. One of the Nazi party members was also killed. It's expected that Chancellor Hitler will not easily forget the violent incident. He wants to eliminate all communists in Germany. He's made that one of his government's top priorities. The head of the Hitler press office says that the Chancellor's new government will not tolerate any experiments of a financial or economic nature, including any type of economic experiments by communists. Even though Chancellor Hitler is often considered by some to be power-hungry and tempestuous, some German watchers believe he will be less dangerous in government office than he is in the street commanding his stormtroopers.
That was shown in movie theaters in February 1933 after Hitler came to power. Think of what they said, less dangerous. Now, at the end of February, they burned down the Reichstag, and Hitler declared emergency decrees to outlaw civil liberties, demonstrations. Shortly after that, they got rid of political parties. And on May Day, Hitler invited all the labor leaders. He said, let's have healing. Let's come together. Let's have consensus. And he invited all the labor leaders to Berlin for a conference on May Day. They marched with the Nazis. The next day, they were all arrested. The unions were shut down, and under Wilhelm Frick, they set up the Nazi Labor Front. Now, as you saw, the torchlight parades, and some of you have seen photos of Nuremberg rallies, Hitler used Wagner's operas as the basic idea of pageantry and so on. So there's a direct connection in two ways. You can do the connectos, you know, from Wagner, his son-in-law, his daughter-in-law, directly to Hitler, to his family today promoting the same thing. But it's more important to look at the emotional and so-called intellectual connection. This attack on classical tradition. This is what Romanticism is, and this is why it's absolutely legitimate and correct to say that Romanticism kills. So that's what I wanted to present, and then why don't we just open the floor for questions. Well, this was the original IMF, because the war reparations were completely arbitrary. The British went into debt, the French were in debt, the Germans were in debt at the end of the war. But what the Allies did, and I think initially it was 20 million Reichmarks or something like that, but the Germans couldn't pay it, and so interest increased. At a certain point, the French went in and took over the Rhineland to take over the industry, the coal, and so in order to get it back, they had to pay more. So they started printing money. And as Lynn talks about, that beginning in March of 1923, you had, it basically went like this. 1 mark, then 10 marks would be equal to 1 mark. 1 mark equals 10, and then 100, then 1,000, and then on and on and on and on. And so there's stories. Actually, Helga makes this funny joke about how today, with people in the stock market, they all want to be millionaires. Well, she said, big deal, everyone in Germany was a trillionaire in 1923. It's just that a loaf of bread cost $1 trillion. So in order to pay this, they had to shut down the economy and print money. And so you had a hyperinflation which wiped out virtually everything. So then they renegotiated it in 1923, and the guy who was brought in to implement the austerity was a man named Hjalmar Schacht. And Schacht was essentially an agent of Montague Norman, the head of the Bank of England. And so he was the one who had the deflationary policy, and he was credited, he was called the wizard. I don't know if he was called that or if he called himself that. It's sort of like Greenspan. Schacht later joined the Hitler government and was finance minister until 1939. When he had a pang of conscience and left. Schacht is one of the people who was tried as a war criminal at Nuremberg and was one of the only ones acquitted, whereupon he was immediately hired by the Rockefeller family and worked for Standard Oil in Indonesia. So again, you see the oligarchy and so on. But anyway, the reparations weren't that much. They were a lot. But Germany couldn't pay them, so they kept growing and growing and growing. It was only when Hitler came to power that the Allies renegotiated and stopped charging and let Germany rearm. And your second question.
Okay. What was the communist, like when Hitler became chancellor,
mm-hmm.
What was their economic alternative to what, to be said in the thing?
Yeah.
They didn't want any kind of...
This is the classic left-right operation. The communist policy... They basically said, take away everything from private sector and make it all nationalized. And that was no answer either. But the point was that you had a left-right counter-gang fight going on in the streets, and the bankers decided, the communists are more frightening than the Nazis. Let's bring in the Nazis to crush the communists. Now, there was a third alternative. Lynn has always said, actually, it's from the Talmud, when you have two bad options, always choose the third. You had Nazism, fascism, or communism as two alternatives. What was the real alternative? It was the Lautenbach plan, which was based on the Friedrich List idea of national economy, of infrastructure, public works, protectionism. This was based on the American system, Friedrich List and Henry Carey. This is what Lautenbach proposed, and this is pretty much what the New Deal represented, the general welfare. That the state will ensure that people have jobs and they'll build something. And von Schleicher implemented that, but before it started to work, he got dumped. And so the oligarchy in Germany said, we're not going to have a New Deal, we're going to have Hitler. And we think we can control him. Yeah, Karen, you got a question? Well, his name is Hjalmar Horace Greeley Schacht. He was born in Brooklyn, but his father was German, and he moved back to Germany very young age. Yeah. Yeah. Look, what you'll find is that what's characteristic of Wagner and then the so-called culture that follows is the nihilism. That's taken for granted today. That's in our popular culture everywhere. Nihilism means destruction of everything civilized. Disbelief, you don't believe in anything, pessimism, cynicism. To put it colloquially, expect shit, get shit. You know, that's all there is in this life. So get along with it. And it's this idea that there's no higher purpose. Go ahead. E.T.A. Hoffman. Yeah. Offenbach wrote an opera using Hoffman's tales and the... Well, I'm not sure. I'm not familiar with the opera. But the key thing with Hoffman is that he wrote these stories that they're all ghosts, and but there's no purpose to them. You see, the Nordic mythology and the Greek mythology had a common origin. And this is something that actually is quite useful to in understanding Nietzsche. It's beyond our story, but the discovery of Indo-European language came about in about the late 18th century. Wilhelm von Humboldt discovered that the language of Sanskrit and in India was the same as the languages, the cognates, the languages of Northern Europe. And so they were looking, you know, what does this mean about migrations and things of this sort? But the idea was that it's intelligible. Language has a purpose, which is to develop ideas. But what the Nazis did is they took the mysticism of Tibet and came up with this notion of the Aryan people. So the use of mythology by Wagner was with no purpose, whereas if you read Homer, if you read the Greeks, and you study how Aeschylus, for example, uses mythology, it's part of this process of man suddenly realizing, instead of having to propitiate all these irrational gods, there actually is a composer of the universe. There is a creator who organized things in a certain way. It's not just anarchy. And so again, those are the two different looks. Yeah? Houston or Houston, I'm told, actually. Well, he's the one of the ones who popularized them. The Tibetan symbol, yeah, because you had this, again, this idea of, look, I don't know if you saw, again, I hate to use Hollywood for this, but there was a movie not too long ago, and I don't remember the name, but it's maybe 7 years in Tibet or something. Brad Pitt, typical of Hollywood, he's playing a guy from Germany who was a famous mountain climber who ended up in India and then had to escape, and he ended up educating the current Dalai Lama. Now, what Brad Pitt didn't know when he signed up for the part is that his character had been a leader of the Nazi youth. And so the movie, of course, whitewashes that. So here you had a Nazi youth leader ending up in Tibet being the tutor to the Dalai Lama. And it's, again, this Aryan mythology that was used by the Nazis, that there were superior people with blonde hair and blue eyes from the north who are the same as the Brahmins of India, and that this is one group that should be ruling the world. Again, the mythology becomes real because people don't know what is the relationship, for example, between Sanskrit and German. How does a language convey ideas? Who cares, man? We want the pageant and the spectacle. Well, let's take a look at a situation today. There's massive genocide going on in Africa right now. There are, between the AIDS epidemic, which is striking between 20 and 40% of people your age in southern African countries. There are civil wars that are being promoted and run out of London with backing from Washington, with arms trafficking and so on. That those people who aren't dying from disease are being killed in civil wars over what? Just wars of depopulation, so the raw materials can be taken. Now, why is it that in the United States, there's no dramatic movement to fight this. Not just among African Americans, but among any human being. Because these ideas, Charlie, that I've been discussing, take over. And it's not that you're sitting there saying, I want to go out and kill Jews. I hate people. It's that you just have a passivity towards the profound, dramatic struggles of nations to survive, including our own. Anybody who knew anything about economics would realize that Alan Greenspan is a babbling fool. And yet you watch MSNBC, CNN, any of these channels the night Greenspan makes a speech, and you see these guys in awe saying, well, Greenspan has spoken, and we're translating it right now into English, but we think it means buy, buy, buy. And what do people do? They call their broker, oh, tomorrow when it opens, I'm going to buy, buy, buy. And the broker says, hot damn. And you get the broker watching the same show. Now, the market goes up, and then it crashes. And as it's crashing, the broker says, don't worry, it's turning around. Now, the same person who's buying stocks sees factories being closed. They see their parents being, or grandparents, kicked out of nursing homes because they don't have money. You see all this going on around you. Now, is it that you're sitting there saying, this is great because now the Ubermensch, the Superman, can take over and crush all these cattle and we can rule? No, you're too busy dropping acid or whatever. You know, I don't know what people do these days. What's the drug at the raves?
Ecstasy,
right. Well, yeah, the big drug, watching television, watching Jerry Springer. What do you see on Jerry Springer? The human cattle. And so you have a culture that's degraded, and what's taken away from it? The image of man. The actual human response is if you see a child hungry, shivering, without parents, in the wilderness, you take that child with you. You help that child. But as in the case of the so-called Christian morality of the Falwells and the Ashcrofts, you have this idea that was described very beautifully by this guy who was appointed Surgeon General that Ashcroft defeated, who said, these Christian fundamentalists are pro-life from the moment of conception to the moment of birth. Then after that, who cares? So again, how can you have people who profess to Christianity, to be followers of the mission of Jesus Christ, who say, we're going to preserve your right to live, even if we have to blow up the abortion clinic, even if we have to shoot the abortion doctor. You know, pro-life guys defending killing doctors. But then what happens after the baby's born? Your mother better get a job. And don't expect vaccinations. And we're going to help you with school by having private schools so our buddies can run them and make money. So, you see, Charlie, this is what I'm saying. If you think this through, you have this view of the world that's all around us. We have a proto-Nazi culture today. And you didn't even have to listen to Wagner to get it. And that's the point. That's what we have to go out and organize people to recognize. That the fact that they don't have an emotional response, and I don't mean just, you know, you have the typical emotional response, Sally Struthers on television raising money to send blankets to Afghanistan or something like this. People get played for that, but the real response should be, why are children suffering? We can produce food, we can produce anything we need. Why does anybody have to suffer? It's because evil exists, not in alien empires out in space, but in each of us to the extent that we don't challenge our axioms. To the extent that we don't challenge how we think. And that's what you've got to talk to people that you go to school with and people that you know and people you live near. Look what happened when they had the illusions about Hitler. Hitler is going to look like a Sunday picnic compared to what we face today because there are already more people being killed in southern Africa by these policies than Hitler killed. And when Lynn said this in 1976, he was called an anti-Semitic extremist. Because supposedly he was diminishing what Hitler had done. Now, some of you probably don't know this, but in 1976, we had a demonstration outside of the IMF headquarters with a big casket. And we said, IMF, rest in peace. Long before the so-called left today discovered the World Trade Organization, the IMF, and this alphabet soup of fascist global institutions, we were fighting them. Because that's what it means to be human. You find the source of evil and you go after it. And if it's in you, then you have to develop your aesthetical capabilities. That's what Helga sometimes calls polishing your soul. You know, we all have tarnished souls because we live in a terrible civilization. Now, you live in this civilization, but you're not part of it. And your job has to be to change it. Yeah. Hey, you saw Apocalypse Now. Look, Hollywood, the Wagnerians came to Hollywood in big numbers in the 30s. And I think Jeff Steinberg will be talking about this, Adorno and the Frankfurt School. They studied the Nazis and they said, how can we have the same effect of the Nazis without necessarily having to do it as a nationalist movement? How can we have a global Nazism? That's what the Frankfurt School was about. Adorno, he'll tell you about Adorno, studied Wagner and Nietzsche and said, these are great ideas, but they've been a little discredited by the Nazis. Or look at the people like the Bush family, who promoted Nazi eugenics, the belief that African Americans and non-white, non-Aryan peoples are inferior genetically. And then after the Nazi period, you couldn't publicly come out and say that. So they had to create new forms of racist belief. Like, well, blacks, after all, have very good talents. I mean, they have rhythm. Whites have cognition and blacks have rhythm. And you just like you don't want to see a white person dance, you know, you don't want to see a black person in college. So, yeah, right. So you create this. I mean, all you have to do is watch Al Gore during the campaign of the black church trying to clap while they're singing. And you know there are certain things that white people don't do too well. But the argument that that's genetic, you know, is a fraud. But people like Bush, and it just came out again, the bell curve from Harvard. How come people didn't storm Professor Murray's office and throw him out of the university? Instead, he gets $25,000 to go and give lectures all over the country about how blacks are, it's a mistake to have social programs for African Americans because they'll never amount to anything anyway, and all you're doing is artificially raising their hopes. Yeah, well, and now they're also saying, and the Jews are superior. We love the Jews. You know, the funniest thing is to see the Southern Baptists out there saying, my Jewish friends. And, you know, they're really saying, we want you to go to Jerusalem. We're going to do everything we can to help you get to Jerusalem so you'll be incinerated by Armageddon so Jesus will come back. And you see the American Jewish community saying, oh, we love our brethren because we're going to get them to fund the Israeli army so we can incinerate the Temple Mount. And it's all racial. It's not about ideas or humanity. So I cut you off, but go ahead. Okay. You were just a natural.
I was a natural Nazi. I thought I was making breaks on something. This is kind of how the world works. Yeah. Without ever even really seeing anybody take these ideas, it was through the media that I was making these, you know, connections. Okay, this is how this works, this is how this works. And it was, I mean, I might as well have been reading Nietzsche. I might as well have been, you know, learning.
Well, see, in Pattenby's day, we actually did read Nietzsche. Huh? Yeah, I know. So, I mean, the point is that the idea of a cultural paradigm, think about what I said about an axiom. You don't sit down and say, okay, do I believe man is good or do I believe man is evil? Do I believe that I have this divine spark in me or do I believe I'm just a creature of the senses? But you don't do that. You just are in a culture which imposes that on you.
That the Romantic period came to slam the classical period. What was the reaction of particular classes at that time? Were the lower classes, did they see an influence of the music of Mozart and Bach actually stimulating, and that's why they had to?
Yeah, there was a big fight over, I mean, Mozart was right at the center of this. You think about Schiller and Mozart as being promoters of the American system. The question is, if you live in an oligarchy, how do you promote these ideas? Now, Schiller's idea was you set up a German national theater that's available to everyone so that everyone can come in and see Joan of Arc, can see the story of the tragedy of Don Carlos, so they can become educated and they can actually learn history, but more importantly, that they can develop their senses. You use poetry, you use music to transform people. Mozart was enraged most of his life about the fact that to be a musician, you were basically an indentured servant. You're practically owned by a nobleman. Mozart's father was controlled by the Archbishop of Salzburg. And when Mozart went to Vienna, his father was deeply distressed because he thought this would be more punishment on him, and he was right. Now, Mozart worked with the Emperor Joseph II. Joseph II was an interesting person because he was actually conducting reforms in Austria. He was conducting educational reforms. He was transforming the country. And he was supported by a group of elite, the Baron von Swieten, I can't remember the other name. But they liked the idea of the American Revolution. And so they were trying to use the emperor to bring these ideas in. And so Mozart had this conception of his operas. In fact, before, at the very end, just since we've had so much ugliness, I want you to listen to a piece of ending of a Mozart piece. But Mozart's idea is you use drama to show the beauty of people. Now, Mozart, I'm going to play for you in a little while this from The Marriage of Figaro, which was written by, it's a play by Beaumarchais. Beaumarchais was someone who bought cannon for the American Revolution against the British. Mozart, as a child, when he toured Europe, got to know Beaumarchais. And Mozart's idea was to bring these ideas of the American Revolution, of equality. But he was a good guy. He didn't say, let's kill all the noblemen. He didn't want class warfare. He said, maybe we can change some of them so we don't have to have a violent revolution. Now, of course, the French Revolution, the British turned it against the nobility. There's this famous saying by Robespierre, who was the leader of the terror, who said the revolution has no need of scientists. And they killed scientists. They killed, just like Pol Pot, the French Revolution, which started with ideas of the American Revolution, got turned into a Pol Pot-style jihad against the intellectuals. So Mozart said, look, we've got to have a reform which doesn't require this kind of killing. The Marriage of Figaro is a story about a servant and his betrothed who are about to get married, and the count, who's of course a modern count, but never, so that means he's renounced the automatic right to sleep with the virgin before marriage. But even though he's renounced it, he still wants to do it. And so the thing is a series of conspiracies where the count is conspiring to sleep with Susanna. Now, Susanna has to wake up Figaro, her fiancé, to figure this out, because, you know, he's all happy, and he doesn't even realize that this plot is underway. And then there's the Contessa, the wife of the Count, who is about to be betrayed. So there's conspiracy after conspiracy, and in the end, they trick the Count, they set a trap, and they catch him in front of the whole townspeople. They catch him thinking he's singing to Susanna, who he's about to seduce, and it turns out it's his wife. But he asks, and he's complaining to her, she's asking for forgiveness, and he says, no, 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 no. And then when he's exposed, he asks for forgiveness. And imagine a count in front of his whole population. So they say, okay, you can be forgiven. Now, 2 years later with Don Giovanni, the statue comes to dinner with Don Giovanni, and says, you can repent. And Don Giovanni says, no, 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 no. And he goes straight to hell. So Mozart's idea a couple of years later is forget it. But his last opera, The Magic Flute, is about the secret societies. And the secret societies of brotherhood and wisdom, they should be opened up. So he puts on the stage the story of the Masonic orders, which at that time, the Masons are a mixed bag, and Tony Chaitkin, if you want. You can find him, and he'll talk to you for hours about him. But Mozart's idea was that he was going to take this to the people, these ideas, these beautiful ideas of equality and uplifting. And so instead of doing it in the court, he went to what was called vaudeville, the biggest theater in Vienna. And that's when they killed him, because they didn't want the population to have access to these ideas. You look at what happened to Schiller, that they tried to, every time he set up a magazine, they shut it down. Then you look after the Congress of Vienna in 1815, when they tried to suppress this. By 1819, they passed something called the Carlsbad Decrees, which outlawed the performance of Schiller's plays in Germany. So the oligarchy does everything they can to keep great culture from the population. Now, they may want to keep court musicians, you know, to entertain themselves. And generally, you know, you go to an opera sometimes and you see all the very wealthy people there to show off their fur coats and their jewelry, and that's just the men. But the idea of great culture is that if we had a great, beautiful culture in this country, you wouldn't have this indifference to suffering. You wouldn't have this pessimism. You wouldn't have this do-your-own-thing mentality. And so the purpose of this is specifically to promote the bread and circuses for the masses, and at the same time convince people that that's their expression of their individuality. So you get everybody doing the same thing at the same time. All of a sudden, everyone gets tattoos and they say, I'm an individual. You know, just like earrings, long hair. You know, when I was in college, the more you looked like a guy who hadn't been shaven or showered in months, the more cool you were. Yeah. Well, that's the same thing, what you had with the Beatles, 1963. It's a turning point. With Kennedy, you had a return to the FDR idea, to science, to technology, to cultural optimism. What they degrade by calling Camelot, if you look in history now, they talk about this was the period of Camelot. Camelot was another one of these mythologies, King Arthur's court and so on. Kennedy was fighting the oligarchy. He didn't really figure out that he had tools to fight them until toward the end of his life. But Kennedy was reconsidering the question of the arms race, mutual and assured destruction. You know, after meeting with De Gaulle, he started thinking about, gee, maybe the French have a point. He was considering pulling out of Vietnam. But he was also fighting Wall Street, because they wouldn't lower interest rates, so the steel industry was collapsing. Kennedy issued treasury notes to get outside the Federal Reserve. So there are a number of things, and Kennedy, by the way, there's a in Dallas, Texas, they have on the sixth floor of the Book Depository building, where it says on the plaque where Lee Harvey Oswald allegedly shot John F. Kennedy. So the people of Dallas aren't all crazy. But anyway, you go up there and they have these little tapes, the videos, and you see Kennedy greeting Pablo Casals in the White House. Not George Strait or Clash or, you know, Bush is bringing country western back in, whereas Clinton, I mean, with Carter, it was the Allman Brothers. But anyway, he's greeting Pablo Casals, and what does he say? He said, a nation which doesn't concern itself with the arts as much as it does business and science is a nation which can't bring out its inherent goodness. You get rid of Kennedy, and what have we had in the White House since then? Yeah. I mean, you have the worst, and now, so the Beatles. 1963, the Beatles come in. Jeff will talk about this also, but there was a project launched in the 20s by Arnold Schoenberg to figure out how to create music that was primarily rhythmic and sensations, emotions. And this was what was done repeatedly. And you think now about what do you have with the music today? It's primarily a driving beat, you know, little kinds of rhythms, little tricks and gimmicks, but at heart, it's all about how you feel. And this is what was done. I mean, think about, someone was arguing with me the other day, and they said, well, John Lennon was a great poet. Yeah. I want to hold your hand. I want to hold your hand. Please let me hold your hand. Well, at least it rhymes. Let me tell you something. I think you'll understand. When I feel that something, I want to hold your hand.
What about that song, though, talking about a revolution?
Well, you see, what is a revolution? You got to think about what kind of revolution. Now, if you want to sell, if you're in a counterculture where people are rejecting their parents' values, that's not a revolution, because there may be some values that are good. There may be something that went on before that's worthwhile. And this idea of the revolution, you know, I mean, John Lennon talked about, imagine if there were a world without war and this and that. All right, how do you get it? You got to fight the people who were sponsoring John Lennon. So you have to ask yourself, what's the point of this? You think about, I mean, think about it. Think about country western music today. And songs like, if you want to keep the beer real cold, keep it next to my ex-wife's heart. You know, or my wife ran off with my best friend, and I miss him. Drop kick me Jesus through the goalposts of life. You know, you've got, it's a mentality of losers. You know, there's this one song, how can you use being drunk, being in jail, losing your wife, running over your dog, and having a pickup truck in one song? That's the model, huh? Yeah, right. So, and then you have the Bush family who just loves this music. Now, what is it they love? It's the sense of degradation and littleness and being a victim. Then you think about rap. And you know, we have this fight all the time. Rap music, if you don't have a word that rhymes with bitch or hoe, you have to go to a dictionary. You know, and, you know, you see, I'm not saying there aren't people who were talented or had ideas. But the point is, instead of learning what they could from people who had developed these sciences to the maximum extent in their lifetime, what they want to do is invent everything over again based on what? How I feel. The pigs are out after my father. They shot my brother. I got to get down. And you know, but also, it becomes what gets promoted. The most extreme anti-woman mentality. The most extreme life doesn't mean anything, so I'm going to shoot those effing pigs. And so it brings, it's rage. Beauty doesn't come out of rage. If something is evil, don't just get enraged about it. You go out and fight it. I like what Rudy back there said in talking the other day in this meeting we had, where he went in and he was lobbying and he saw these legislators who don't know anything about electricity. They don't know anything about Enron. They don't know anything about anything except getting reelected. And they were talking to them, and these guys were just saying, yeah, well, yeah, regulation sounds good, but we can't do it. Now, by the way, we all know how to put toothpaste back in the tube, so we can solve this one. So Rudy, who you know has a real sense of fighting for justice, didn't just say, I wanted to smack those mothers in the mouth. No, he said, I was saddened by what I saw. And that's the proper emotion. You feel the pain of the fact that there are people whose lives are going to be meaningless unless you act. Now, are you inspired to act by a country western song or a rap song or a Nine Inch Nails song or Rage Against the Machine or some of these things? Yeah, you might be inspired to act in a way that's impulsive, foolish. You know, maybe you'll rage against the machine and shoot somebody or get shot. How's that going to help? This question of reason, intelligibility, and it's not dull, sterile reason. Reason, as Schiller talks about it, is with the emotions. So, you know, you listen to the Beatles and you sit there, especially if you've been toking on a joint for a while, and you know, it makes you feel mellow. What does that mean? It means getting away from reality. The better you feel about it, the more you are removed from the reality. And then the more likely you are to vote for Bush or Gore. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You have to deny your real nature.
You have to deny life, living, and truth. deny it by being ignorant of it, by not knowing where it came from. So when you make the statement that there's something wrong with that, something wrong with that, there's something wrong with this, and these people act out of rage, you have to also consider is that how do you get from there to here?
Mm-hmm.
No,
you see, that's a good point. Alright, well, what Lynn said a long time ago at one of the classes I attended, which I found very interesting, is that evil starts as a lack of development, lack of personal discovery. Think about Socrates saying, know thyself. Now, the problem is that when you live in a bad culture, how do you find a way out of it? Now, that's why Lynn emphasizes the importance of working on music, working on the singing voice, having everyone sing, to actually discover that beauty is within, but it's something that has to be developed. And Lynn talked about evil as the lack of development. And he compared it, and at first I thought this was kind of funny, but he compared it to growing up. You know, you think about a baby. A baby doesn't know right from wrong. A baby can't take care of itself. You know, a baby is totally controlled by the mother or the father. And the question of maturing in a society is developing the capacities in yourself for reason so that you can be the person who seeks the good willingly. Now, if you want to destroy a society, the best thing to do is to destroy education so that a child ends up in a school where they have Bush tests, where everything is multiple choice, and you spend all your time studying to pass the multiple choice test, instead of developing the faculties of creative thinking. Now, how do you do that? Lynn has written extensively about this. You have to have a classical curriculum where you go through the great ideas in history, the great discoveries, and you don't just turn to the back and get the answer. What did they discover? You go through the process. That's why at our cadre schools, we go out and look at the stars. We sing, get everyone singing, so that you actually find in yourself the capacity to make these great discoveries so they become a part of you. Now, if that's missing, and all you know is Nine Inch Nails and Waylon Jennings and Jerry Springer, there's a problem, but here's the solution. It's you. It's organizing. Organizing is going out and showing people that there's a whole world out there that they've been cheated from. They've had taken away from them. That in a sense, growing up in this society is, you're not given a chance to really discover what it means to be human. And doing it with humor, getting people to laugh at what they believe, laugh at themselves, and figuring out ways to do that. And it's not that there's a LaRouche joke book. It's that irony comes from your ability to look at a situation and help someone discover that their life is a paradox or a series of paradoxes. That's the organizing process. Now, the other point, though, is that you really have to make yourself beautiful. And I don't mean FaceTime in the mirror or hours of pumping iron. You know, I belong to a spa because I was told by a doctor I have to exercise so I don't get high cholesterol. So I go there and I watch these guys that, you know, are human cattle in the sense that they take the same steroids that they give cows. And they're sitting there in the mirror with rock music blaring, you know, looking at their muscles. They spend hours watching their muscles. Now that's turning people inward. The idea of beauty is how ripped you are, how buff you are. You know, and my generation's horrible. You know, we're all getting paunches and double chins and gray hair. And you know, that means we're out of it, because it's all about you. But if you actually work on perfecting your soul and do it over your whole life, people, and you radiate that beauty, then you can take on this ugly society, this ugly culture, and get people to laugh at what they've accepted. And that's the whole fight. Anyone on this side have any questions? For some reason, it's always... All right, go ahead.
My question is, in organizing, there's a lot of frustration in organizing a population that's been so degraded, or I don't know what the right words are, but to go out and try to organize and get people to even come to a meeting, that in the area where I'm at, it seems like there's meetings going on all the time. Pretty insignificant meeting, but we're been stupefied to a point in where it seems like we're chasing money all the time, and the little time that we have to give to our family to fill this family values that we think that we got to put a lot of energy into too. It's important, but I'm really frustrated in the last couple of years of trying to do work to get people to come to a meeting. And
all right.
Maybe I want the instant gratification because that's what I'm used to. But
you heard Lynn's speech the other day where he talked about the fact that we're about to come into a period of hyperactivity. Now, one of the mythologies is that when things get bad, people will automatically get smarter. That's not what Shelley meant when he said that man has the potential to grasp profound ideas about man and nature at times of crisis. Has the potential. If there's no leadership, you'll have a Nazi movement, which is what the fundamentalists and various other things are pushing. How do we protect ours? How do we take care of my family, my race, my nation, my people? So, you know, I was not too long ago in Salt Lake City, and I gave this presentation on the economy, and people were freaked out. They said, "So you think it's going to crash soon?" And I said, "It's coming down." And so the guy said, "Well, so that's why we got to protect our right to have guns." And, you know, I said, "Look, if you're going to have that outlook, how many of you have beef jerky stored up?" And they all raised their hands. "I got beef jerky. I got one." You know, so people tend to react to the idea of biological survival. But even biological survival requires thinking, which means you have to defeat the enemy, which means you have to get policies which can rebuild the economy. So Lynn is saying, and I've seen it, you can see it now. How many people have been doing organizing? Let me ask it differently. How many of you are relatively new to organizing? Have just been organizing in the last 6 months or so? Now, are you finding that you're getting people, it's easier to get people to come to meetings? And some of you aren't. Join us on a campus. Go to a campus, because you'll find all sorts of weird things. You'll have all kinds of crazy arguments, but there are, I will tell you, there are a growing number of people who are basically saying, "I'm looking at my future and I don't see something I like." I mean, isn't that pretty much, Maria, what you discovered?
Well,
I mean, for yourself.
Oh, yeah, my own experience, yeah.
Yeah.
I had no idea what I wanted to do. All I knew that I was interested in, knowledge, like philosophy.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we've started something in California, which I think we can do everywhere, where we have, and some of you have met some of the people here from California, where we've been going out on the campuses, and we get a whole lot of people, some of whom agree with us, some of whom don't agree with us, some of whom want to come to meetings to challenge me into a debate of some sort, and you know, sometimes it's hard to debate with someone who doesn't know much, but that doesn't stop them from debating. But what you'll find is that out of that, you have a growing number of people who are starting to figure it out. Why does it happen first with young people? Well, there's something different about young people that some of you may know if you've thought about your own situation. You don't have a mortgage. You don't have a career. You don't have a family. I mean, children and so on. You can pack up all your things in a suitcase and a knapsack and You know, as in the case of Nick, Nick came out with one pair of pants. I think he had one shirt. Well, let's not start talking about the Labor Committee pay scale. But Nick came out, and you know, it was easy for him to do it. Now, if you're organizing in a farm sector where someone's trying to save a farm, you know, I know George is frustrated because George goes out and talks to people who are losing everything. And you say, well, come to this meeting. And they say, I can't. I've got to meet with my attorney. Then I got to meet with, you know, my guru, and I got to meet with my bankruptcy lawyer. And so some people have a more difficult time. But youth are sort of like what they used to do when they to find out if there was gas in a mine. They'd take a cage with a canary, and the canary would die quickly if there's gas. The youth today are moving because they're seeing more clearly than others that there's a problem with the future. And they're capable of dropping things and saying, I've got to figure this out. And as in the case of Maria, if you want to know the truth, this is where you'll find it. And we're not going to give it to you. You've got to work to get it. You've got to experience it for yourself. But that's where we are with organizing. Now, I think we're going to have, look, with these layoffs, with everything else, what happens when someone loses a job? They got to find another job. They got to file for unemployment. They got this. They got that. At some point, they're going to sit there and say, well, why did the auto industry just shut down? Why did Dell Computer just lay off, what, 1,700 people, Curtis? Austin, Texas, one of the big growth centers of the country. Silicon Valley, there are layoffs. You have people who had 90,000 a year jobs with stock options, and for a while the stock options made the millionaires. They went into, Lynn talked about $300,000 tar paper shacks. They got $1.5 million tar paper shacks in the Silicon Valley, right, Mercy?
Oh, yeah. The mayor resigned in Silicon Valley. I mean, he's back in because the rent was too high.
Yeah, the mayor of a city resigned because he couldn't afford to live in the city. Now, when those things start to happen, people start to say, why is this happening? And what you've got to do is catch them and just say, you've got to figure this thing out before they just go into a rage and a reaction and a hateful or suicide. Suicides are up. I mean, people do things that are self-destructive. You know, you have more and more phenomena of people going postal at work, you know, pulling out a gun and shooting coworkers. So what I would say is, just keep working at it, and if you've got a campus near you, go to the campus, try and find some young people.
Maybe you need to quit focusing on the 40 and over and start working on the 20.
Well, my generation is tough. You know, my generation, on top of everything else, we got a little bit of education. We think we know everything. So, but, you know, even the baby boomers are starting to, you know, you get a $100,000 margin call the day after you're fired and you start worrying about what is the future. But, you know, I think, look, on this question of organizing, the thing that I've found over the years is that there's nothing more fun than challenging someone else on things they think they know. Whether you do it with geometry to show people they don't really know anything about how the physical space is organized. And I know some of you spent some time with Dennis Speed and Zeke Boyd working on geometric constructions. Suddenly you find out that things you thought you knew, like the fastest connection between two points is a straight line, and you find out that's not true. When people start discovering that things they just took for granted are wrong, and they can figure out how a space is really organized, then you can change them. But you can't just go out and say, ah, boy, she's no good. We got to get rid of them. Yeah, okay, well, let's go out and do something. What do? You've got to organize people. And organizing requires ideas. So you can't get frustrated. I mean, look, Lynn's been at this longer than I have, much longer than I have. And you look at Lynn, there's no one more enthusiastic, because this is part of a process of self-discovery and development of your own self in the most noble profession of all, which is the perfection of human society.
So you really just gotta figure out how to bring out prison.
Yeah, get people to think. Get them to think. Yeah.
Not so much with it. We've got a pop culture, and we're losing classical culture.
even those who listen to classical music and enjoy classical music don't really understand its significance, and they may also enjoy Wagner or some other instrumental music and New Age music, but don't understand why is classical music great, what ordering principle it has.
Yeah.
And very few people do. Among the small number of people who do listen to classical music.
No, it's true, and that's why, that's what you think about if you grew up as a musician in Mozart's time. The only music that Mozart knew was the court music, which was, his father was a composer, they had the music around them, they had the Italian singing, but every child was trained to sing bel canto. And so you never knew, or you always knew, that you had a voice, that you had the most beautiful instrument God ever created, which is the human voice. And all of us have it, and it's in all of us, it's organized in the same way, the way the sound is created, the way you get the sound in the right position, the way you can, through bel canto, you can get a voice, you can be heard at the end of a hall, at the vast hall, and that there are principles, not just of learning to sing, but of then putting voices together. And if a child learns that, then music is not a question of arbitrary taste. Like someone says, well, your opinion is classical. My opinion is all classical music is good. I like Wagner. I like it all. Plus, I like, you know, Willie Nelson. You know, and they say it's opinion. And so, again, the question is, well, is opinion, what is opinion based on? Are you willing to go out and say, I'm ignorant by my opinions? Because in a sense, if people know the world is organized in a certain way, and then they say, would you walk off a cliff because you don't believe in gravity? And you know, you've got to get people to think about how they think. And that's why I know John will talk about this question of music, so I'm not going to go into it anymore. But look, it really is, you have to get people to defend what they believe. Because even people who want to do things that are good, you know, classic case, a nice liberal wants to help feed the children, wants to help do this, do that. So you say, all right, to feed the children, we need parity. I don't know anything about that, but I'll send soup cans. Or this is what these idiots at the State Department did at the last G7 meeting. Here you have people dying of AIDS in Africa. You've got poverty in Africa. And what do? We're going to uplift them. We're going to make sure every village has a computer. And then someone said, but they don't have energy. Oh, we'll send a battery. And then you have to ask the other question, well, but they don't have phone lines. What do they do, cell phones? Oh, a woman with a computer in an African village can log on to the Dr. Spock website to find out how to raise a child. And you say, well, how about food and water? Can they get that? So, that's right. So, you know, you've got to get people, even people who are well-meaning, don't understand what has to be done. We got a big task, but I'm telling you, it's going to be, if you are on your toes, and if you're working and thinking and developing your minds and developing the beauty in you, then you'll become a better organizer. And so, just assume that the problems you're having are to some extent your lack of development, and keep working on yourself. And as we get into this period and things start breaking open, the better you've prepared yourself to know economics, to know the scientific ears, the better you're going to be as an organizer. And I think the proof that it works is the fact that there are so many of you, including younger people coming to these conferences now, who, I mean, we haven't had this since a student movement, since I was a student. You know, we used to have no one but students at our conferences. And so we're actually beginning to see this kind of explosive potential. Did someone have a question over here? Yeah, Carl.
Organizing young people?
Yeah.
When people are afraid, why you should stay in school to have a foundation?
Come on, Carlos, we've talked about this over. I'm kidding.
that's the type of thing that now I get.
Yeah. Yeah.
But they want to stay there and take
well, you know, it's a I was talking with, you know, Elizabeth from UCLA. She was telling me that she's saying she needs to have the degree. And I said, well, if you sit down with Phil and me, you think the first question we're going to ask you is, what's your education? Oh, you have a degree at UCLA. Okay, you're hired. No, I mean, the thing, you have, everything's falling apart. Now, I think the choice people have to make, what we have to say to them, is that if you get a, you know, if someone comes to a couple of our classes, I mean, make this decision yourself after the next 3 days. I assure you that if you pay attention these 3 days and you work on the ideas, you'll have something more valuable than a four-year college degree. In fact, the most important thing is, with a four-year college degree, you have what Lynn calls the terminal degree. You figure, now I've learned what I need to know, I can shut off my mind, get a job, shut off my mind, and that's it. And that's why it's good to have people who are not just young students, but also some of people who have been through some fights and wars and battles over the years.
And there won't be any jobs yet.
Well, you may have jobs running, you can get a job as working in a private prison. You know, this is a big growth industry in the United States, private prisons. HMOs, you can always work in an HMO telling someone, sorry, we can't give you the operation. So, but to be totally serious about this, what each generation has to decide, each individual in a generation has to decide what they want to do with their life. And right now, we're at a moment of time where we don't have a lot of time. This crisis is rushing upon us. We've got an administration which Lynn has said is going to be clearly discredited in the world within 60 to 90 days. And this bombing of Iraq the other day has practically discredited the Bush administration with the rest of the world, except for Tony Blair and his controller, the Queen. So this thing is happening quickly. Now, if you stay in school, you can still organize. I mean, the point is people can organize on the campuses, they can organize if they have jobs, you know, whatever. But if you really want to be in this fight now, want to make sure we succeed, you have to make a decision. And I think this, you know, it seems a lot harder because a lot of times people are in school for their parents. Right? And you're partly doing something because this is what you were told you should do. And it's sort of like taking poison because someone says if you take enough poison, it might make you stronger. You know, at a certain point, you have to make a decision. I'm an adult. I'm living my own life. Are we pretty much out of time?
Well, I think we can take one more question.
Okay, yeah.
I have a question. I was just referring to, well, one thing I've been telling students is that, well, the school doesn't really value you as a human being. They just value you as somebody who's going to give them money, right? You know, if you pass, then you're considered a good student. But they don't really tell you that you're a genius. You're capable of actually making a discovery. And they go, oh, that's true. Just got to keep going with that.
I mean, I think if you, everyone who saw was at the internal yesterday and heard Lynn's opening statement, where Lynn laid out the crisis and he laid out the job we have to do. I mean, this is the kind of thing that to me, seeing Lynn in that kind of circumstance just completely inspires me again, this idea that we can win this fight if we do what we have to do. And what does it mean to do what we have to do? It means we have to keep working on improving ourselves. Well, why would you want to live in this world and degenerate? And really, even starting with early education, you go through a process of degeneration. A child stacking blocks at 1 year old or 1.5 years old is actually doing more creative work than you do in a whole senior year in college. Because that child is making a discovery about the nature of space, whereas a senior in college is basically plotting the options. And, you know, as I've been pointing out, you go get an MBA degree because you're learning how to fill out unemployment forms. So.
Frustrated whether or not I was creating a scheme on one hand or not a plan on the other. Also, you must understand, I was invited to LaRouche anyway, because this is what my parents set up for me as a child, in terms of, I know classical music, my parents were classical, my parents were jazz musicians, but I, from the age of 8, throughout 4 grueling years of my life, had to take piano lessons. And I didn't take piano lessons playing Thelonious Monk, it was fine. Okay? And they made me do it. The point I'm trying to make is this. Nobody is advocating about my school. You have to look at it like this. School is your graduating from college is your key to the capital, where you can get in there and fight the oligarchy because you're in their environment. Because unless you are qualified, quote unquote, you know.
But Curtis, you, come on, you know, I know. But what you're presenting now, Curtis.
No place to go.
Yeah.
It is the most frustrating thing in the world. There is literally no place to go. But the point I'm trying to make to you is that the journey, the struggle, the journey is worth it. It's a beautiful journey. I actually have a book with you. It's the actual translation in from the Russian into English of Joseph Steiner's book on synthetic geometry, his first work. I've actually worked through all of those things. When you work through that, you begin to understand certain beautiful things about the world and nature that you can't get to by the methods that you teach in school.
Yeah.
Because they want to make you what I see in Austin. What do you want to do? You want to create employees with their own computers, a world-class citizen. You got a choice. Because an employee with their own computer can't become a world-class citizen, but a world-class citizen always learns that to take a job. And so, like I said, the point I'm trying to make here is that realize that the political point, that's what I'm here for. I'm here about the organizing. I mean, Harvey's like not just Boston, he's down in Houston, but I've been in this thing for 2 years. I have fought with a variety of other people in Houston about the fact that I am not ready yet. I got into this to educate myself, and when I'm through with my education, I'll go out and I organize just a little bit, and I'm doing a little bit more the next year, and I'm a little bit more the next year, and I've been really.
All right, listen, we're somewhat short on time, so let me make the point. In the Jewish Passover Seder, every year you say next year in Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Now, what that meant in the old days and in reality is that we're going to improve the world by next year. Now, of course, it means we're going to destroy Jerusalem, but this idea of next year, the Spanish culture, mañana es mejor, you know, we'll do it tomorrow. We don't have next year unless we fight now. So I appreciate what you're saying. We got to compact your studies so that we can get more people out organizing now. Now let me just finish by, since I did present a lot of ugliness, I want to just finish with this last scene from Mozart's Marriage of Figaro. Now, unlike Wagner, just 1 second, unlike Wagner, where everyone's standing around and one person speaking in music, here, if you can imagine a stage, you're in the audience and you've got over here, you've got one group conspiring. Here you've got another. Here you've got the Count who thinks he's about to hop on Susanna, and he finds out it's really his wife. But before he finds it out, he tells her she's been wrong because he thinks she's been running around with someone else. So she says, will you forgive me? He says, no. And then the veil comes off and he sees it's his wife. And so the Count, in front of all these people who have been conspiring, falls to his knees and begs for forgiveness. So I'd like you to just listen to this and see that this may still be the Valkyrie, so.
Yeah, definitely. You're back.
Yeah, they're back. They just go on and on and on. Okay. All right, so here we have Mozart, the end of the Marriage of Figaro. This is when Figaro and Susanna make up. This is the count who's now come into the room, into the area. He's asserting his authority, and I'm about to make the great leap, yeah. And then Susanna and Figaro are in the background with their conspiracy again. Off her mask, and he sees he's been fooled. And now he's asking for her forgiveness. With the count in front of the villagers on his knees asking his wife for forgiveness. And she forgives him. Feels a certain compassion for this pathetic count, and they're basically saying, okay, you know, we'll give him another chance. But I think you get the idea of how classical beauty can defeat the ugliness of Romanticism. So